In our news file, we will be discussing U.S. Secretary of State Anthony Blinken urges preservation of democracy as he kicks off African tour. And finally, inflation rate hits the top around the world and supply chain issue is worsening this shortage of food supplies as food prices rocket in post-pandemic areas. Hello again and welcome. First in our top stories, Sudanese Secretary Forces fired tear gas today, Thursday morning, at dozens of protesters manning barriers in the capital, Khartoum. Police have remained deployed in large numbers in North Khartoum, where demonstrators kept up their protests through the night. Aguila Saleh, the Speaker of Libya's Eastern-based House of Representatives and a political ally of General Khalifa Haftar, announced that he will run in the country's presidential election in December, claiming that he is willing to unite the institutions in the country, support security, and create a mechanism for accountability and control. Libya's presidential and parliamentary elections are set to take place on December the 24th under a UN-sponsored agreement reached by Libyan political rivals during meetings in Tunisia on November the 15th, 2020.
We are working to overcome the past, to close the page of conflict in the country, to open a new page and look at the future in a healthier way, and to initiate national reconciliation. I will try my best to unite the institutions in the country, support security, and create mechanism for accountability and control.
As Ethiopia's war nears the capital, Addis Ababa, the United States warns pilots that planes operating at the hub of the Ethiopian Airlines and the busiest Africa's airports, the Bole International Airport, Addis Ababa, directly or indirectly exposed to ground weapons fire or surface air-to-air fire. Marwa reports.
U.S. this week urged its citizens in Ethiopia to leave now, saying there should be no expectation of an Afghanistan-style evacuation. The Federal Aviation Administration advisory issued Wednesday cites the ongoing clashes between Ethiopian forces and fighters from the northern Tigray region, which have killed thousands of people in a year of war. The Federal Aviation Administration advisory notes no reports of disturbance at Bole International. Could increase if the Tigray fighters encircle the capital. The Tigray forces, who had long dominated the national government before current Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed took office in 2018, have approached Addis Ababa in recent weeks and joined up with another armed group, the Oromo Liberation Army, with the aim of pressing Abiy to step aside. The Tigray forces also say they are pressuring Ethiopia's government to lift a months-long blockade on the Tigray region, which includes an Ethiopian government restriction on flights over Tigray. The Federal Aviation Administration advisory also says the Tigray fighters likely possesses a variety of anti-aircraft capable weapons, including rocket-propelled grenades, anti-tank weapons, low-caliber anti-aircraft artillery, and man-portable aircraft defense systems, or man pads which could reach up 25,000 feet above ground level. UK Minister for Africa Vicky Ford last week told reporters that Britain now advises against all travel to Ethiopia apart from the airport for departures and transfers.
U.S. Secretary of State Anthony Blinken said in his tour to three African countries that Washington is working closely with Kenya, Addis Ababa and the African Union to put pressure on all parties to stop the fighting in Ethiopia, urging African countries to remain vigilant against what he called the growing threats to democracy. Let's follow this report.
U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken arrived today, Wednesday, in Nairobi, the first stop in his first hour since taking office to countries in sub-Saharan Africa. during which he will focus on democracy and climate change. In a press conference with his counterpart, Rachel Omamu, Kenya's cabinet secretary for foreign affairs, Antony Blinken praised Kenya's role in seeking to reduce the conflict in Ethiopia, considering it as a vibrant and an inclusive democracy, despite the challenges it faced in its recent elections.
I very much appreciate President Kenyatta's engagement on this, including at the United Nations and in person in Ethiopia. We're working closely with Kenya, the African Union, and its High Representative for the Horn of Africa, former Nigerian President Obasanjo, as well as other partners. Our Special Envoy, Jeff Feltman, is working with High Representative Obasanjo to press the parties to end hostilities immediately and without preconditions, to stop human rights abuses and violations, to provide humanitarian access for the millions in northern Ethiopia who are in dire need of life-saving supplies.
For her part, Rachel Omamu expressed her happiness for choosing Kenya as the U.S. first station in this African tower and described the relations with the U.S. as strong and thriving.
That the United States and the Republic of Kenya have a very special relationship, a unique relationship, a relationship that dates back very many years. The whole object of this visit, and this is my second point, is to rejuvenate, is to reaffirm, is to deepen this very special relationship. And I thank you for choosing Kenya as your first port of call as you begin your maiden visit as Secretary of State to our wonderful continent.
Beside Kenya, Washington traditionally ally in a region that is witnessing a growing Chinese presence. On his tower, which will continue until Saturday, the U.S. top diplomat will visit two other countries that are essential to President Joe Biden's African strategy: Nigeria, the continent's most populous country, and Senegal, which is an example of a stable democracy on a continent that has often experienced bloody conflicts. Blinken hopes to chart a different path in the Biden administration than former U.S. President Donald Trump, who did not hide his disinterest in Africa, and was the first U.S. president in decades not to make any visit to the African continent. The visit of the U.S. Secretary of State comes weeks before Biden hosts a summit of democratic countries in Washington, and days after the end of the climate conference COP26 in the Scottish city of Glasgow, where Washington joined calls to move away from the use of fossil fuels that pollutes the air.
And to talk more about Blinken's visit to Africa at a time when some African countries are witnessing political unrest, including Ethiopia and Sudan, Amal Ushnan, researcher in conflict and peace studies, joins us live from Turkey. Well, Amal, how can Blinken's visit help reducing political unrest in non-stable African countries, including Sudan and Ethiopia?
Actually, I think that the crisis in African countries are structural and need a structural solution process. I don't think that this visit will solve this crisis, whether it's political or security crisis, as much as it's going to raise the American policy in Africa and American role, especially in Africa, within the increasing influence of China. I believe that U.S. will use its tools to make a pressure, and also Blinken will hold direct talks and consultations with the leaders of these countries to support mediation and resolution efforts in Ethiopia, especially with Nigeria, whose former president Obasanjo is expected to play a mediating role between the conflict parties in Ethiopia, and where he is trying to reach a solution to the ceasefire in Ethiopia. Also, the United States is expected to activate the financial and security assistance mechanism in dealing with some African countries, as it will provide security assistance to Nigeria, most probably, which is an important country for the global energy markets. At the same time, I think that the U.S. already suspended $700 million aid to Sudan against the army commander. And also it imposed some sanctions against Ethiopia within the human rights abuses there. And as a final stop, I think Blinken is going to visit Senegal, which is a more stable country in comparison with other African countries. And he's going to focus there on some like development issues, sustainable development and entrepreneurship. And Senegal is very important also to the U.S. because it's going to share the African
Thank
Union
you.
In 2022.
Thank you. Amal Ushnan, researcher in conflict and peace studies, you joined us live from Turkey via Skype. And following the latest reports concerning the high rates of pollution in India and Pakistan's city Lahore, African countries are bearing as well the consequences of global warming and climate change. And of course, Algeria is among these countries. Let's follow this report that highlights the causes and effects of climate change on African countries.
Glaciers are shrinking, ice on rivers and lakes is breaking up earlier, plant and animal ranges shift, and trees are flowering sooner. Our planet is getting warmer as never before. Climate change is the reason. It is a global phenomenon of climate transformation characterized by the changes in the usual climate of the planet. Africa is therefore not an exception. It is actually in Africa that the impact is already most destabilizing. 1.3 billion people remain extremely vulnerable as the continent warms more and at a faster rate than global average. The climate indicators in Africa were characterized by continued warming temperatures, accelerating sea level rise, extremely weather and climate events such as floods, landslides, and droughts. The rapid shrinking of the last remaining glaciers in eastern Africa makes them expected to melt entirely in the near future, a signal of threat of imminent and irreversible change to the Earth system. The continent is on the front line of the impact of climate change, despite having contributed almost nothing to the problem. It is estimated that by 2030, that up to 118 million extremely poor people will be exposed to drought, floods, and extreme heat in Africa if adequate response measures are not put in place. What happens in Africa rightly concerns the whole world. Real action is more urgent for African countries. If people can no longer find a living in their own countries, they will have little choice but to move elsewhere or be pushed into conflict that will risk spreading to neighboring regions. So, it is in everyone's interests to support African countries in addressing its climate challenges.
And to discuss more this issue, Ali Qaratbi, International Cooperation Director at Algeria's Environment Ministry, joins us here in our studios. First of all, hello and welcome. My first question is going to be about the participation of Algeria in the COP26, and you were among the delegation. How do you qualify it?
Thank you very much for your invitation and for this subject, very important subject. So first of all, we have to mention that the COP26 this year was not an easy thing to organize due to coronavirus pandemic. More than 150 countries have been represented by from the highest political level till some youth and NGO organization in order to familiarize with the COP and the UNFCCC standards. So to speak about Algerian participation, we can resume the participation on three levels. So the first one was related to the technical session of negotiation. So from the first day to 8 November, we had more than 100 or 200 subjects discussed about technical sessions. Algeria was represented by eight negotiators from different sectors, which have direct link with the climate change. So the second level was the official statement. So during the second part of the high level segment, Algeria was represented by Dr. Sami Mwelfi, the Minister of Environment. So during the official statement, our Minister, Dr. Sami Mwelfi, has delivered the most important message from Algeria in order to highlight the contribution of Algeria in the regional and international level in fighting climate change. And also she has mentioned the efforts done by Algeria and the 34th commitment from our president, Mr. Abdelmajid Tebboune, in improving the living standards of Algerian citizens. So the third level, which was the most important action, was the B2B meeting with some minister in charge of environment from different countries. So we have met some ministers from Africa. You have Uganda, you have Egypt, you have you have South Africa, and some countries from Asia. You have Qatar, and some countries from Latino America, like Brazil.
Indeed, Mr. Ali Qaratbi, with the participation of such major countries around the world, what are the major outcomes of this summit? In just a couple of words.
So the major outcomes of this summit. So we should know that there were two vision from developed countries, which was focused on the enhancing the reporting and the transparency of this complicated process. And was limiting the adaptation concept on the investment in ecosystem and nature capital, and the second vision was the vision of developing countries. Developing countries wanted to mention that the promise of $100 billion from the developed countries was not achieved, so they suggested to do something like evaluation why this promise was not achieved. The second one was the discussion about definition of what is finance, what is climate finance. So in order to clarify more things, and also in order to simplify the access to the different funds, like Green Climate Fund, like Adaptation Fund, and also the Global Environmental Facilities.
Probably not many things were left for the coming COP27. What is after the COP26, and how can Algeria be more effective and helpful in fighting climate change?
So just to complete my answer, mm-hmm. about the main outcomes, you have the Glasgow Climate Pact, mm-hmm. and you have the Africa succeeded to adopt the Glasgow Sharm Sheikh work program of 2 years in order to define the global climate target, and also Africa succeed to maintain an open dialogue and discussion to push developed countries in order to try to identify and define a new targets of financial contribution post 2025. For your question about how we can improve our participation and be more effective for the future. So you have first of all we have to have a real task force for climate, because negotiation is not easy thing. So you should have task force of negotiator in order to participate in the different session. We have also to improve our existing framework of cooperation between countries and other international organizations.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ali Qaratbi, Algeria's Environment Ministry International Cooperation Director. You joined us in our studios.
Thank you.
And to another story now. Zionist occupation forces have killed a 16-year-old boy, Palestinian Ibrahim Abu Qasab. And occupation police forces stated that the operation took place in Al-Balda Al-Qadima, eastern Al-Quds city. Let's follow this report.
Zionist crimes in Palestinian-occupied West Bank are intensified. A 16-year-old Palestinian young man was killed by occupation police forces in eastern Quds city. The martyr was accused of stabbing two occupation policemen, and his parents were arrested few hours after his death, as neighbors and locals showed their support for the young man's parents, which led to direct clashes between the forces and locals, as Palestinian citizens in the area threw rocks on the forces. On the other part, the 39-year-old Palestinian Sami Amour passed away in Zionist custody at Soroka Hospital in the Nakab on Thursday, suffering from congenital heart problems, while Palestinian groups considered his death as a result of medical negligence, which is the prominent policy of Zionist forces that put numbers of Palestinians to death since the occupation of Palestinian territories. Sami Amour was imprisoned in 2008 in Dar al-Balah in Gaza, and he was sentenced to 19 years in addition to banning from family visits. Many high-profile figures in Palestine pledged support for Palestinian civil society groups who were considered terrorist organizations by the Zionist forces. And they warned that the Zionist designation put the whole civil society at risk, and not only the organizations themselves. Zionist crimes against Palestinian civilians is stepping from worse to worse, amid the silence of international opinion and strong resistance of the population.
Belarusian President Alexander Lukashenko and German Chancellor Angela Merkel have agreed to start negotiations at the European level to resolve the ongoing crisis at the shared border. Lukashenko's press service said the two leaders agreed that the problem should be raised to the level of Belarus-EU relations and that officials appointed by each side should immediately start negotiations. On the other hand, Merkel's spokesman Stefan Scheibert said Merkel had underlined the need to provide humanitarian care and return options for the affected people. German Chancellor Angela Merkel said when speaking to the Association of German City Leaders, the fourth wave of COVID-19 hits Germany with full force. She described the pandemic situation as dramatic as COVID-19 cases rise significantly. Sarah Virginie on what follows.
Germany's Angela Merkel has described the COVID-19 situation in her country as dramatic, as the outgoing chancellor considers how to deal with an infection rate that has hit a record.
The present pandemic situation is dramatic. I can describe it differently. The fourth wave has hit our country with full force, and even though there is legal ground for the pandemic national emergency situation, I have no doubt that we are amongst such a difficult situation.
Merkel's comments come after the Robert Koch Institute, Germany's public health body, reported a further 52,826 new cases Wednesday and a further 294 deaths. To date, Germany has recorded 5.1 million cases and almost 100,000 fatalities from COVID-19, according to Johns Hopkins University.
The daily figure of new COVID-19 cases is higher than ever before during the pandemic, and the number of patients is rising very rapidly. And what's also frightening is the number of deaths in the country.
Several states and cities have already imposed more COVID measures and have required the public to show COVID passes, which have an individual's vaccination status or if they've just recovered from the virus in order to access public areas.
Iran rejected the report of the International Atomic Energy Agency of the United Nations on Tehran's nuclear activities, describing it as a politically motivated report, a week before the visit of the Atomic Agency to Tehran. International Atomic Energy Agency Chief Rafael Grossi wrote in his latest quarterly report on Iran's nuclear program that the agency's inspectors had been subjected to excessive physical inspections by Iranian security officials. More in this report.
Hello, everybody.
The International Atomic Energy Agency Chief Rafael Grossi wrote in his latest quarterly report on Iranian nuclear program that the agency's inspectors had been subjected to excessive physical inspections by the Iranian security officials. Claims that have been rejected by Iran, describing it as politically motivated, a week before the visit of the Atomic Agency to Tehran. The spokesman for the Iranian Atomic Energy Organization Parooz, Kamal Effendi, said that Grossi will arrive in Tehran on the evening of Monday, November 22nd. Grossi's visit coincides with the start of the regular meeting of the International Atomic Energy Agency Board of Governance in Vienna, in the week before Tehran and international powers returns to the table of talks aimed at reviving the 2015 agreement that limited Iran's nuclear activities before the United States withdrew from it in 2018. On other part, the United States and its Gulf Arab allies issued a joint statement concluding a meeting in Riyadh, a joint warning to Iran, accusing it of causing a nuclear crisis and destabilizing the Middle East with its ballistic missiles and drones. These countries welcomed the upcoming seventh round of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action negotiations in Vienna, calling on the Iranian administration to seize the current diplomatic opportunity to prevent conflict and crises.
Still with Iran, and according to an advisory issued by American, British and Australian officials, Iran has targeted organizations in the transportation, healthcare and public health sectors by exploiting computer exposures found by hackers before they were patched. The Iranian action has not gone unnoticed by the international community. The attackers utilized the first penetration to carry out other operations, such as data exfiltration, ransomware, and extortion, Sid Islam reports.
Iran has targeted companies in the transportation and public health sectors by exploiting computer vulnerabilities discovered by hackers before they could be addressed. According to officials, the attackers used the first compromise to carry out other operations, such as data exfiltration, ransomware, and extortion. Officials claim the organization exploited the same Microsoft Exchange flaw in Australia. Despite the fact that ransomware attacks are still common in the United States, most of the major ones yesteryear were traced to Russian-based criminal cyber gangs rather than Iranian hackers. The Iranian action is not just being noticed by government officials since last year. Microsoft has observed six separate groups in Iran launch ransomware. According to Microsoft, one of the groups spent a significant amount of time and effort attempting to create relationships with its intended victims before launching spear phishing efforts. As a cover, the organization sends out false conference interview requests and frequently poses as executives from think tank in Washington, D.C. As said by a member of Microsoft Threat Intelligence Center, the Iranians are extremely forceful in trying to convince their victims to click on a harmful once report has been established. Last year, researchers at the cybersecurity firm CrowdStrike claimed they and their rivals began noticing this type of Iranian behavior. The Iranian ransomware attacks are intended for espionage, sowing disinformation, harassing embarrassing foes, and essentially wearing down their targets.
And finally, it is almost exactly 1 year until the official kickoff of the World Cup 2022 Qatar. And we are now starting to see the tournament take shape, with 13 teams having officially qualified in a wait for the playoffs to continue. Abdurrahim Kashour.
It is crunch time on the road to Qatar 2022. But with the Europeans lost nearly done and dusted, there are still several spaces left for the nations across the globe. Qualification picture for the next year's World Cup in Qatar is starting to emerge, with 13 out of 30. Based on criteria that started with number of points, goal difference, and goals, will be allocated to pot 1 and drawn in 6 semi-finals as the home team. The remaining teams will then be drawn from pot 2 to semi-finals 1 to 6. There will be 3 playoffs path, with each providing a World Cup finalist. Semi-final 1 and 2 make up playoffs path A. Semi-final 1 and 2 make up playoffs path number A. Semi-final 3 and 4, number B, and semi-final 5 and 6 will contest the path C. To determine which semi-final winner will play at home in the final, an additional draw will be held for each path.
And before we wrap up, let's have a reminder of our stories. And we discussed U.S. Secretary Antony Blinken urges preservation of